Some of them, like in the Psalms, will repeat something, but they won't put it that way. They will translate it differently, and then you read another account, and it doesn't. So I had to actually read several versions of the Bible to make this list. And one other thing that I did is kind of as an added bonus, because I was writing a book at the time, and I decided I wasn't going to publish it, but it's all done, in addition to things that are repeated directly, Moses, Moses, anytime something is said by somebody, and then there's an intervening chapter or paragraph or something, and he says exactly the same thing again, without having said anything personally in between that. Like when, Potiphar's wife tried to seduce Joseph. She said in Hebrew, Ratzili, lie with me. And then there's this little insert where he says, I would never do this, blah, 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 blah. And then she repeats exactly the same thing, Ratzili. But that's the first thing she said, so it's actually a repetition. So kind of as an added bonus, I added all that in. And there's lots of those in the Bible, too. So the Bible is full of these interesting parallels. And another thing I did is I went through and I counted all of the instances in all of the books. And then I cataloged them, how they are and where they occur. Isaiah will have none for like certain number of chapters, and then he'll have 20 of them, all in three chapters. Repetitions of, you know, comfort, comfort my people, says the Lord. And he goes through, and there's all kinds of, and then he doesn't do it for another four chapters. So I've got it all cataloged in all these different ways and everything. It took me months and months to do it, and then I just never did anything with it. So if anybody wants that, let me know, and I can probably find it somewhere in my computer. But it was a ton of work to get that out of there. And so, and I looked around to see if anybody else had done it first, you know, so I could work on there. And I've never seen anybody that has gone through and done this. So, you know, whatever. There may be a purpose why I did it, and someday the Lord will reveal to me, or maybe he's disappointed that I didn't follow through with it. But I don't know. Anyway, just so you know, this is something that the Bible does do. Moses, Moses. Okay, verse 5, go ahead.
Did not come any closer, Boston. Then he said,
okay, where else is that mentioned in the Bible? That exact same terminology.
Shoes or holy ground or both?
There's one holy ground. Take off your shoes. This is holy ground. Where's the one other place that that's mentioned in the Bible? What's that? Okay, I'm getting to it right now. I'm just trying to find the exact account so that we can go through it. And let's see here. It came to pass, people. Hang on here. It's in the account of Joshua, and it's right when he goes over the Jordan. And let me see here. It would be after 4, because they went over the Jordan in 4. And it says the angel of the Lord came up to Joshua. And I think it's right before the Battle of Jericho. But anyway.
How about Acts? 7:30.
Yes, that is in there, but that's a repetition of the account we're reading. Hang on one second here. Okay, here it is. It says, and it came to pass. No, that's not it. Okay, here it is. It's Joshua 5, verse 13 is where it starts. And it came to pass when Joshua was by Jericho that he lifted his eyes and looked, and behold, a man stood opposite him, with his sword drawn in his hand. And Joshua went to him and said to him, are you for us or our adversaries? So he said, no, but as the commander of the army of the Lord, I have now come. And Joshua fell on his face to the earth and worshipped. And the Lord said to him, and it says, the Lord said to him, Adonai, it's capital L, small O-R-D. That's Joshua saying to him, what does my Lord say to his servant? Okay. Then the commander of the Lord's army said to Joshua, take off your sandal off your foot, for the place where you stand is holy. And Joshua did so. So we have the Lord, his glory is being concealed in a burning bush. The burning bush is not the glory of the Lord. It is concealing the glory. By the fact that we're seeing fire, it's protecting him from seeing the glory of the Lord. But then in Joshua, we have this account where a man is standing there, and he is proclaiming that he is deity. And Joshua fell down on his face, and he worshipped him as deity. There is no way around that. This is exactly the same thing as what happened with Abraham when the three men came, and he called him Lord. The term Jehovah, L-O-R-D, is used, and Abraham used the term L-O-R-D, capital L-O-R-D, which is Adonai, meaning God, okay? There can only be one answer to this, and this is God incarnate. This is Jesus Christ. And I, as I said before, and I don't want anybody to just simply believe me on this. I want to explain what I believe. I can't defend it, and I don't want other people to just run with it without at least thinking it through. Is that I believe that the Lord that we are talking about in Joshua chapter 5 that I just mentioned is Jesus. It is Jesus after having been born by Mary. He is physically a man. I don't believe in a pre-incarnate Christ. Everybody else that you ever talk to or read their analysis is going to say, this is the pre-incarnate Christ. That's a contradiction in terms. He was not incarnate until he was incarnate. And therefore, I believe that somehow, as Lord of the universe, and as the one that defeated death, he is wherever he is right now with Enoch and Elijah. He is outside of time as we know it. And he goes back and he actually intervenes in his own history. I know that sounds insane, so think it through yourself. But here's why I believe that. Here's one reason. I talked about this last night when I was doing something. But, they took away my pens. Yes, what happened to them? And let me see if I can find them. If I can't, then I'll just have to show you with my fingers. But, you see them? Oh, there they are. Yeah, somebody must have been doing something last night. But this is why, this is one of those things that I think through. It doesn't mean I'm right, so please don't just believe this blindly. But let me have any one of those. I don't care. Just, there we go. As I explained this when I was talking to some people last night, but this is the menorah, and I've brought this up in the class before, okay? That's the menorah. All right. This is a picture of the 7,000 years of human history. If you believe in a literal translation or a literal six-day creation, which I believe, before I get into this, let me ask you a question. Could God have created everything exactly as it is in 10 seconds?
Yes,
yes he could have. Could he have done it over 17 billion years? Yes, he could have. So there's no reason to not believe the Bible as it's written. 6 days for creation. Okay? This is day one or zero up to the year 1000. Okay? And then from 2000 to 3000, and then 3000 to 4000, and then 4000 to 5000, and then 5000 to 6000, 6000 to 7000, and this is 7000. Okay? Might as well take a minute and just divert from what we're doing. The year 4000, right now the Jewish people say that it is Anno Mundi, meaning from creation, 5771. That's what they say the year is. They have finagled this date. It is not 5771. They've gone back in about the time of Abraham, they dropped a few years. At another account, they dropped a few years. A guy named Usher, Cardinal Usher, back in the 1600s, I believe, did a book called The Annals of the World. You can buy it. It's a big volume. It's giant. And he has not only the biblical account, but he's got things that have been lost to history. He went all over Europe, and he got things about the Peloponnesian Wars, and he got things about this, and all of these documents that no longer exist. But what he did is he copied them, and he compiled them. And he said, this is the biblical account God created, and then this Greek war happened here, and then this, Scythian war happened here. And he just adds it all up, and it's this giant masterpiece of work of all the things, and he says, on this day in human history, this battle took place in France, and it's marvelous. Anyway, he did a ton of work, but his work, along with some other people, have documented that we are not in 5771. We're very close to the year 6000, just so you know that. And why would they change this date? Why would the rabbis go through and finagle the date so it doesn't read 6000?
They're trying to change history.
They're trying to change history to get away from the Jesus thing. Same thing they do with the text. I think we talked about, I talked about the text in the Saturday night class. But there are certain variations in these texts. And why are they in there? And it's because the rabbis don't want, and we'll go through one of them real quickly
prophecy
when I get done.
Fulfilled.
Right. It is prophecy fulfilled, but it's not only just prophecy fulfilled, but it is so specific that if any of their people were to read it, they wouldn't have a defense against it. So 5771 instead points to Bar Kokhba as their Messiah. And they'll say, yeah, he was our Messiah, Bar Kokhba, which came after the time of Jesus by a couple hundred years. Anyway, he went back in the land of Israel, and he had this rebellion. And so anyway, Bar Kokhba, I think it means the star. Anyway, Jesus came at the year 4000, okay? If you go by the annals of the world, some people say it was the year 4004. But anyway, from Anno Mundi, the year 4000, okay? This is called the Shamash. It's the middle candle, and it's called the Shamash. The Shamash means the servant. The servant candle. Why? Because they light this one and then they light the other ones off of it. So Jesus the servant came at the year 4000. Everything in history pivots on the year 4000, his birth, death, crucifixion, burial, and resurrection, okay? And that's why I believe, however it is, this is just me and I don't want you to believe this, I just want to explain why I believe what I believe. What happened here is the light of the rest of the world going back in both directions. That's why I believe in an eternal Christ, not a pre-incarnate Christ. Somehow he was able in his own history to go back and affect these things, and it's the book we read. He's the beginning and the end. He knows both directions all the way. Anyway, coming to the final point, God created in 6 days, and each one of these is a picture of the 6,000 years of man on earth, and then God's rest right here. The 1,000-year millennial reign of Christ, and it, what does it say in the book of Isaiah? His resting place shall be glorious. He is sitting in Jerusalem in God's rest. Redemption is done, and all we're waiting for is the end of the 7,000 years and then off into eternity. Okay? Could get more involved in that, and I quoted quite a bit of it last night as to why I believe this, but here's a good example. I'll give you a couple of them that come right to mind. What does it say? Jesus, when he was 12 years old, was in the temple, right? And his parents went back home. They couldn't find him. And what does it say? It says, after 3 days, they found him sitting in the temple. Okay, well, I have to back up, and I'll tell you that 2 Peter 3, verse 8, is a quote of Psalm 94. Who wrote Psalm 90?
Moses.
It's the oldest psalm in the Bible. Psalm 94 says, a day to the Lord is like 1,000 years, 1,000 years like a day. And 2 Peter 3:8 quotes that. So he is making a comment that at times in the Bible, you will be able to discern that a day period is a 1,000-year period. Okay? Not always. But it says that Jesus was 12 years old. They found him sitting in the temple. After 3 days, they found him in the temple. Well, when did the Jews get exiled? Right here. Okay? And they have been exiled up until here. 2 days on this calendar. After 3 days, they will find him sitting in the temple. He will be there. He will be teaching them and instructing them, just as the picture made. Okay? I hope you understand what's going on there after 3 days. Another one is in Matthew, I think it's Matthew 17, the transfiguration. It says, after 6 days, they went up on a high mountain. Jerusalem is called the high mountain. Get ye up into the high mountain, right? They saw him on the high mountain and his face shone and he was glorified. What is it going to be? After 6 days of human history, 6 days is like 1,000 years, 1,000 years like a day, there will be Jesus glorified for all the world to see. These are pictures. Every single thing that Jesus did, not just his words, but the things he did, the way he moved, the places he did things and the times of day he did things, all are a living parable. Everything. When he fed the 4,000 and when he fed the 5,000, there was a different term used for basket. One is kophinos and one is spuros. Why would he do that? There's 12 little baskets or 7 big baskets. Why would he do that? Every single thing that he did had a purpose. And he even asked him, don't you understand? They weren't cluing in that he was making a parable of himself and all of his deeds. I won't get into why the kophinos and the spuros right now, but anyway.
What year is it, if it's not 57?
Well, I don't know exactly, and I'd have to go back and read something I read years, and I hadn't even thought of this for about 5 years, but somebody did it, and it's later, by a couple hundred years. So we're at 59-something. We are very, very close. And I don't think even the guy that did this research, because the Bible is not completely specific.
Right.
And I may be wrong on that, so it's been years since I read this, but he substantiated all of the missing years and why and how they hid those for this date. But we are really close to this time. And that's why, you know, Israel's back in the land, okay? What does it say in Hosea chapter 6? It says, after 2 days, he will visit us. On the third day, he will raise us up that we will live in his sight. Once again, that's a picture of this one. Their exile. He will visit us. On the third day, he will raise us up. The Jewish nation will again be the center of the nations and all of, what does it say? The law will go forth from Zion and the nations will stream to it and et cetera, et cetera. So all of this, that is not making stuff up in my own head. I honestly believe that this is a correct analysis of these particular verses. But there are other times it says 3 days and it's not some prophetic picture. So you got to be careful not to insert that all the time. But you can logically make deductions that what is being said is there for a reason. Why else would that story be in there? of him being 12 years old and astonishing the people. It's a cute story, but it means something more.